The Bible tells us, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." It says to receive with meekness the implanted Word, which is able to save your souls, and to be diligent to present yourself approved to God, rightly dividing the Word of truth. Join us now for the 3ABN Sabbath School panel. Our study today is The Least of These.
Hello, friends. Welcome to our 3ABN Sabbath School panel. If you've been tuning in, we thank you for your consistency. We also thank you for your prayers and your financial support of this network, which we believe is anointed of the Lord to do a work that He alone receives the praise for. And the Sabbath School panel has become, in your words, one of the favorite programs on 3ABN. But keep praying for us, because this is not a tiptoe through the tulip work. It's a diligent work that we praise God to be involved in. Today we're talking about the cry of the prophets. And this is a particularly challenging lesson, because when you think of prophets in the Bible, they have had a diligent work to do. God has anointed them to do something that was not something that was preferential, but it was in fact mandatory. And when you follow God, you cannot make decisions about what to say and what not to say. So follow us today. We're going to be talking about something that's really important. And it all fits into the context of how God has been involved in repairing a broken earth through work, through justice, through taking care of the needs of the poor, through relationships that are being bound together that have been fractured over the course of human history. And each of us today has a lesson that will address the cry of the prophets in particular. But first of all, let's meet our panel. To my immediate left is Mollie Steenson. Always good to have you back.
Thank you. It's a joy to be here.
And your Mollie-isms, is that what they call it?
I'm afraid there are Alabama-isms. I don't know.
Well, good to have you here.
Thank you.
And Shelley, how you doing?
Oh, I'm doing great. Always a pleasure to be here and learn from each and every one of you.
That's right. And the man with the plan, Pastor Ryan Day, good to see you.
It's good to be here, brother.
That's right. I appreciate you, all the gifts God has given to you. Praise the Lord for that. Yeah. And Jill, the list lady.
The list.
I always look for that list. I know I'm redundant on that, but I appreciate every bit of it.
It's a privilege to be here and to learn from each one of you and to study God's Word.
That's right. And we're going to do nonetheless today, but we need a power that is not something that's resident within us. So bow your heads as I ask Jill to take us before the Lord in prayer.
Holy Father, we come before you in the name of Jesus, and we just thank you for the gift of your Word. Thank you for the gift of your Spirit. And we just ask right now that you would tune our hearts and our minds, that we would receive what you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
The cry of the prophets, the memory text, and by the way, to get a copy of the lesson, let me just let you know that, go to the following website, absg.adventist.org, and download a copy. But if you don't have access to a computer, or if you prefer a live audience where you can study together, go to your local Seventh-day Adventist church. Just type it in, Seventh-day Adventist church, and the Lord will lead you, and you'll find not only wonderful fellowship, but solid Bible students. The cry of the prophets. Let's look at our memory text. It comes from the book of Micah, chapter 6 and verse 8. You know, Old Testament prophets, I just take my hat off to them. When you look at the declaration of Stephen, just by the time he was about to be stoned,
yes,
he ran through, he literally summarized the work of the prophets and how God used prophets through the ages as constant calibration of the journey of his people. Well, look at the words of Micah the prophet here. Micah 6, verse 8. He has shown you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God.
Amen.
When you think of prophets, we often think of bearded men, long gray, but then when you read the Bible and you hear Jeremiah says, I'm too young, I'm just but a youth. When you think of the call of some of the prophets and the kings of Israel, some of them began to reign when they were 16 and others when they were 8. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking, I wouldn't even give the car keys to the lawnmower to an 8-year-old. Mm-hmm. Am I right?
Absolutely.
Just take out the garbage. That's about all I'm going to trust you with. But the Lord has seen in his wisdom to choose men before they were molded by the influences of the world and put them under his tutelage and develop their minds and mold their minds. I think of Uzziah. how Uzziah began to reign when he was 16 years old. Yeah. Well, some 16-year-olds get excited when they get their own room for the first time. But he reigned for 52 years, and what a beautiful life. But it says of him, he was marvelously helped until he became great. Mm. So what I want to point out today in the very beginning of any role of leadership that anybody is called to leadership, don't ever let your greatness get to the place where you use God's tools to rob God of his glory. Mm. That's a dangerous thing. And Uzziah, when you think about the reforms, and years ago, I always remember that text in Isaiah chapter 6, where it says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on his throne, mm-hmm. high and lifted up.
That's right.
And it baffled me until one day I decided, why is Isaiah talking about Uzziah? And I looked at his life. And it was amazing how God called him. And that man's life was a trajectory of success after success after success until one day his success became the God that he worshiped. And when he denied God's rebuke, leprosy broke out on his forehead. And the Bible talks about two famous lepers. Naaman was a leper, but the Bible says of Uzziah, he is a leper. Mm. And he died in a house of leprosy. So the greatest danger in a prophet's life, and by the way, another word for prophet is preacher, a proclaimer, because prophets were to proclaim things to come. And today, you know, the gift of prophecy is not just a gift to prophesize, to give trajectories of what's happening in the future, but it's also a gift of proclamation, proclaiming the word of God. And so despite God's clearly detailed plan for the Israelite nation, they just ignore the prophets over and over and over, and they fell into the category, or chasm, I would say, of the request that we're going to look now in 1 Samuel 8 and verse 5. They fell into this chasm that brought them untold failure in leadership. Mm. And I'm referring now to the reoccurring call to justice, which is our Sunday's lesson. Notice the request of the Israelites. And they're speaking to Samuel, by the way, and they said to him, verse 5, look, you are old. Now, I don't want to even run past that because an old prophet is better than a young prophet without wisdom. Come on, Mollie, get a man. An old prophet is better than a young prophet without wisdom. Mm-hmm. There's certain things. I remember when I was in New Guinea years ago, and I viewed in a community up in the mountains of New Guinea. I was watching, and they had these reoccurring circles, small circle, larger, 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 and larger. And I noticed that the ones on the outer ring were the younger boys. And it seems like the ages increased as the ring got smaller. And I couldn't help and ask, what's this ring all about? And they said, the older man, the wiser man, sits in the center of the circle. You have to earn the right to get close to him.
Amen.
Because his age brought wisdom that the younger men couldn't appreciate. You had to earn the right to get close to that circle. And so when they came and sat up for their daily lessons, they sat on their ring and they surrounded. Wow, and when you had to earn the right to get close to that older man. And in our society like America, we put older people in buildings and say they're past their usefulness. But Samuel, they told him the same thing. You are old and your sons do not walk in your ways. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations. And boy, did they get a king. Did they get a king. He was tall and handsome. He was everything that the eye could have. Mm-hmm. But what was on the outside did not match what was on the inside. And look at 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 10 to 18. What was Samuel's warning to the people in response to their request for a king? Now, I'm going to read this because there are many of you might be in a church where you're saying, you know, this is the kind of pastor we need. And we get committees together now and they talk about the kind of pastor they want and they pre-design pastors. And sometimes when the pastor shows up that begins to become the pastor in your church, you say, that's not what we asked for. Well, you know what I've discovered, panel? We could ask for something, but God knows what we need.
Amen.
And so if the Lord sends you somebody that doesn't match your preferences, God knows your need rather than your preferences. 1 Samuel 8, verse 10 to 18, notice this. So Samuel told all the words of the Lord to the people who asked him for a king. And he said, this will be the behavior of the king who will reign over you. He says, I know about this guy. He will take your sons and appoint them for his own chariots and to be his horsemen, and some will run before his chariots. Notice, as a self-centered man. He will appoint captains over his thousands and captains over his fifties. Will set some to plow his ground and reap his harvest. If you see his, it's the self-centeredness of his leadership. Right. And some to make his weapons of war and equipment for his chariots. And then it gets even worse. He will take your daughters to be perfumers, cooks, and bakers. And he will take the best of your fields, your vineyards, and your olive groves, and give them to his servants. He will take a tenth of your grain and your vintage and give it to his officers and servants. Mm-hmm. And he will take your male servants, your female servants, your finest young men, your donkeys, and put them to his work. He will take a tenth of your sheep, and you will be his servant. And you will cry out in that day because of your king whom you have chosen for yourselves. Mm-hmm. And the Lord will not hear you in that day. Mm-hmm. Wow. What a rebuke.
Yeah.
Well, you know the story of Saul. And there are two things in the Bible that are reoccurring, two reoccurring statements that I want to share with you right now. Go to 2 Kings chapter 12, verse 2. This is the first one. 2 Kings chapter 12, verse 2. My wife and I, we love studying our Bible together, and this is something that we have a new Bible. I'm highlighting it. But Jill, read 2 Kings 12, verse 2, and notice the statement here.
Jehoash did what was right in the sight of the Lord all the days in which Jehoiada the priest instructed him.
Okay, he was not afraid to take instruction. Mm-hmm. And what kind of life did he do? He did what was right in whose sight?
Sight of the Lord.
In the sight of the Lord. Many people look right in your sight, but in the sight of the Lord is the question, who are they?
Yeah, amen.
And that's the thing that we must always exemplify, not how people perceive us, but how God perceives us.
That's right.
A workman that needeth not to be ashamed, who is he approved unto? He is approved unto God. Amen. One of my favorite devotionals, Oswald Chambers, says, if we live our lives wanting to be approved unto God, we will be approved unto men. If you live a life that's just approved unto men, you will not necessarily be approved unto God.
Right.
He did what was right in the sight of the Lord. Oh, would that be your desire to do what was right in the sight of the Lord? We can easily impress the masses, but are we right in the sight of the Lord? And 1 Kings chapter 15, verse 34. Whoever gets there first, read that. Well, 1 Kings chapter 15, verse 34. I'm just winding mine up on a very important point.
He did evil in the sight of the Lord and walked in the way of Jeroboam and in his sin by which he had made Israel sin.
These are the two parodies in the life of the kings and the leaders of Israel. In Samuel, Saul, Solomon, David, they all fall into these one of these two categories. He did evil in the sight of the Lord. And let me just go ahead and segue to the next day on this note. I want to spend some time on the important values of leadership. It is not what we do in the sight of men that determines greatness, but what we do in the sight of the Lord.
Yes.
And what promise has the Lord made to us? 1 John 3, verse 22. And whatever we ask, we receive from him. But here are the conditions. Because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight.
Amen.
The judgment will be in Ecclesiastes 12, verse 14, for God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil.
Amen.
Mollie.
Well, I have Amos. So go to the book of Amos, and let's just look at what Amos says about himself. And so I think I want to say it this way because he reminds me of me. He says, look, y'all, I'm not a prophet, and I wasn't the son of a prophet. But God has given me a message for you, and I'm going to give it to you. So let me read that for you. It's, I was neither a prophet nor the son of a prophet. That's Amos 7, 14, and 15. But I was a shepherd, and I also took care of fig trees. But the Lord took me from tending the flock and said to me, go prophesy to my people. Mm. So now, what does a prophet do? Amos tells us in chapter 7, verse 8, the Lord says to Amos, behold, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. Now, here's what a prophet does. Does a prophet usually come, Pastor Lomacang, with a good message for the people? Why does God send the prophet in the first place? Something's the plumb, you are out of plumb. What, when you drop a plumb line What's the purpose of the plumb line? See, you build a wall and you drop the plumb line. What does the plumb line show
straight
you?
Line.
Either the wall is straight or the wall is crooked. So God sends his prophets to walk right down the middle of our churches and drop a plumb line. Now, in the nation of Israel, they could do what, and we see it all through history, where God would send a prophet to a people, and he would drop that plumb line, and the people had one of two choices. They could
straighten
the wall, or they could kill the prophet. Now, how many times did they kill the prophet? Because straightening the wall rarely ever seemed to be what the people wanted to do.
Right.
So it's interesting to note that Amos prophesies during a period of time in Israel when Israel was doing great. Business was booming. Their boundaries were bulging. So on the surface, it looked like Israel was doing just fine. There was money in their bank account. Their kids were behaving. And so they were self-sufficient. Okay. What does God look at? Does he look at the outward?
No.
Okay, here's where we get in trouble. God looks below the surface.
Yeah.
In the nation of Israel, below the surface, there was greed and injustice.
Mm.
Hypocritical religious motions had replaced true worship, which had created a false sense of security and growing callousness to God. So Amos is given a message from God to go to the nation of Israel. So I want to delve into this message that Amos has been sent to deliver. Amos 1:3. Thus says the Lord. He begins on a popular note, listing off the surrounding nations, which are Syria, Philistia, Phoenicia, Edom, Ammon, and Moab, detailing their crimes and their atrocities for which God will promise them. He's speaking as an oracle of God to Israel. And you could just imagine the Israelites applauding these indictments of their enemies, particularly since many of the crimes of these nations, these surrounding nations that surrounded Israel, their crimes had been directed at Israel themselves. Okay, then Amos moves a little closer to home, declaring God's judgment against the people of Judah. Israel's southern neighbor. Remember that the kingdom was split and there was a northern kingdom and there was a southern kingdom. So Israel is the northern kingdom. Judah is the southern kingdom. And so they had split, obviously, because of dissension between them. So Israel's southern neighbor is now the separated kingdom. Speaking on behalf of God, Amos cites their rejection of God, not the northern kingdom, which Israel was, but the southern kingdom, which Judah was. Their disobedience of his commands and the punishment that would come to them. Again, we can just imagine the Israelite people, the people of the northern kingdom. They were applauding as Amos pointed out the wrongdoing of the people of the southern kingdom. Now, do you remember when Nathan the prophet came to King David?
Yes.
And he was ascribing to him this situation. Now, what he was really doing was addressing David's sin against Uriah.
Yeah.
But he gives a little story of a rich man that had a lot of sheep and a poor man that only had one. And the rich man was having a banquet. And he, rather than going to his flock, went to the poor man and got his one sheep. Oh, how did David react to that?
Off with his head.
Off with his head. But what did Nathan do? He turned to David and he said, "Oh, thou art the man." So now we have the northern kingdom. And they're thinking, look at this. Amos is here, and he is prophesying against all of these surrounding us. He's prophesying against that southern kingdom, and they're feeling good about themselves. However, Amos is about to turn his attention to his audience. So Amos 3, 1 through 3, hear this word. Now, something I want to say before I read this. God can't seem to help himself. He can ascribe all of your sins and the degradation, but he's always going to give you that hand of hope.
Amen.
He just can't seem to help himself. So here, Amos 3, 1 through 3. Hear this word that the Lord has spoken against you, O children of Israel, against the whole family which I brought up from the land of Egypt, saying, you only have I known of all the families of the earth. Therefore, I will punish you for your iniquities. Can two walk together unless they're agreed? Now, Amos 5, 1 through 4. Hear this word which I take up against you, a lamentation, O house of Israel. The virgin of Israel has fallen. She will rise no more. She lies forsaken on her land. There is no one to raise her up. For thus says the Lord God, the cities that go out by thousands shall have 100 left. That which goes out by 100 shall have 10 left to the house of... Is he ascribing punishment to the nation of Israel? Yes, he is. Look at verse 4. For thus says the Lord to the house of Israel, what?
Seek
me and live.
Yes.
Verse 14, jump down to that. Well, let's go to Amos 5, 12 through 15. For I know your manifold transgressions and your mighty sins, afflicting the just and taking bribes, diverting the poor from justice at the gate. Therefore, the prudent keep silent at that time, for it is an evil time. Verse 14, seek good, not evil, that you may live. So the Lord God of hosts will be with you. As you have spoken, hate evil, love good, establish justice in the gate. It may be that the Lord God of hosts will be gracious to the remnant of Joseph. The last verses of Amos prophecy point to the future restoration of God's people. Now, I want to read you this quote from Sister White. In Patriots of Prophet, talking about this prophecy that Amos delivers to his people. 10,000 unnoticed mercies were silently falling in the pathway of ungrateful, religious, rebellious men. Every blessing spoke to them of the giver, but they were indifferent to his love. They refused to listen to the voice of God in his created works and in the warnings, counsels, and reproofs of his word. And thus he was forced to speak to them through judgment. Paul tells us in Romans 2:4 that it is the what? The goodness of God that leads us to repentance. But, and there is a but if in our stubbornness we refuse to repent, God loves us so much, he will bring judgment to get our attention.
Amen.
That is, I think, a powerful statement. Oh, God loves us. His hand of love and mercy is always extended to us. In their hour of deepest apostasy and greatest need, God's message to them was one of forgiveness and hope. What do we take away from this, Jill? There are times we need to speak up, address wrong, but always do it with love and a hand of hope.
Amen.
Wow. Mollie, I don't know if it's a Mollieism, but when you said, but God can't help himself.
He just can't.
I love that because he loves us so much, he cannot stop loving us. I want you to think about that as we take a short break, and we'll be right back.
Ever wish you could watch a 3ABN Sabbath School panel again? Or share it on Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter? Well, you can by visiting 3abnsabbathschoolpanel.com. A clean design makes it easy to find the program you're looking for. There are also links to the Adult Bible Study Guide so you can follow along. Sharing is easy. Just click share and choose your favorite social media. Share a link. Save a life for eternity.
Welcome back. We'll continue in our lesson study with Shelley Quinn on the prophet Micah.
And that is, I just loved your lesson, Mollie, on Amos. But if you just go over a couple more books and past Jonah, you find the prophet Micah. And the one thing I wanted to say is that Micah and his contemporaries were called the grieving prophets of doom, because God was calling his people to repentance. They were willfully breaking his covenant, and God sent them down. You know, the first three chapters of Micah, it's pretty much just expressing the anger that God was feeling, the sadness, the disappointment, the anger against the evil that the people had been doing. And he sent Micah to say, hey, if you don't straighten up, you've got destruction coming your way. So let's look at Micah 1 and verse 1. Micah 1, 1. The word of the Lord that came to Micah of Moresheth in the days of Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah, which he saw concerning Samaria and Jerusalem. Now, you talked about the division of the kingdoms. The capital of the northern kingdom was Samaria, and they had fallen into idolatry and immorality so bad that God marked the northern kingdom for destruction. And they were, Assyria came in and captured him in 722. Well, what was the capital of the southern kingdom? The kingdom of Judah. Mm-hmm. The capital was Jerusalem.
That's right.
But worship in Jerusalem had degraded to the point that they were just mimicking pagan worship that was in the north. So these two capitals basically represented all of the entire nations of Israel and Judah. So understanding that, let's look at Micah 2, 8. Micah chapter 2 and verse 8. And this is the Lord speaking, and he says, lately, my people have risen up as an enemy. You pull off the robe with the garment from those who trust you. As they pass by, like men return from war, the women of my people you cast out from their pleasant houses, from their children. You've taken away my glory forever. So what is he saying? He's saying innocent folks are passing by, and you greedy oppressors are attacking them. Yeah. And you're the enemy of the people. You're evicting the helpless widow from their homes, and God's upset. So he says in verse 10, arise and depart, for this is not your rest, because it is defiled. It shall destroy, yes, with utter destruction. If a man should walk in a false spirit and speak a lie, saying, I will prophesy to you of wine and drink, even he would be the prattler of his peoples. So what? Let's unpack that a little bit. The landlords were rich, they were powerful, they were wreaking havoc on the people around them and devising schemes to get the people's land. They were depriving people of their right to the property, which was against God's law. But they had false prophets that were popular in that day who were coming along saying, hey, you know, he's the God of grace. He's the God of goodness. God wants you to enjoy your wine. Enjoy this. They were focused only on God's love, his patience, but they'd forgotten to focus on his holiness and his justice. Boy, don't we need, you know, those prophets were promising a life of self-indulgence, the false prophets. A life of self-indulgence, one that did not demand righteousness and holiness. How much do we hear?
Yes.
The false prophets of today who are doing the same thing. So Micah, you know, God sends him to say, hey, I'm a just and righteous God. And so Micah comes along to give the message. So in chapter 3 of Micah, Micah chapter 3, let's begin with verse 8. He says, this is Micah speaking now, and he says, truly, I am full of power by the Spirit of the Lord and of justice and might to declare to Jacob his transgression and to Israel his sin. Now hear this, you heads of the house of Jacob and rulers of the house of Israel, who abhor justice and pervert all equity, who build up Zion with bloodshed and Jerusalem with iniquity, her heads judge for a bribe, her priests teach for pay, and her prophets divine for money. Yet they lean on the Lord and say, is not the Lord among us? No harm can come upon us. Therefore, because of you, Zion shall be plowed like a field. Jerusalem shall become heaps of ruins, and the mountain of the temple like the bare hills of the forest. So God sent Micah to confront the political leaders, the spiritual leaders, the judicial leaders, who they're perverting justice and they're perverting God's word. And so here God sends Micah. And as I said, these people had misinterpreted God's patience with them as his approval. And because they offered no justice, God's saying, hey, I'm going to hide my face from you. God can't look favorably upon sin. So when his people, when he sent Micah to tell him this, and you know, King Hezekiah repented because of Micah's message. We find that in Jeremiah 26:19. Hezekiah brought down every high place, every stone altar, and every pole of Asherah. But now, as you said, God cannot help himself. So let's look at the best part, my favorite verses in Micah. This is Micah 6:8. He has shown you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God? You know, God's people were his covenant people. They knew what he required of them. He had already shown them what his standards were. And the standards were pretty simply, do justly, love mercy, walk with humility before me. And that just means walk depending on me. Humility is total dependence upon God and upon his spirit. So, but God didn't give up on his people. Look at Micah 7. And well, look, this is, just remember it this way. Micah 7:8-9. I mean, 7:8-9, that's the way to remember. This is one of my favorite scriptures. Do not rejoice over me, my enemy. When I fall, I will arise. When I sit in darkness, the Lord will be a light to me. I will bear the indignation of the Lord because I have sinned against him. Until he pleads my case and executes justice for me, he will bring me forth to the light. I will see his righteousness. See, God was giving them all of these warnings because he loved them. And he's saying, hey, if you just come to me, I'm going to turn things around. You may fall down one time, two times, three times, four times, however many times you fall down, you, I'll get you up again. Now go on down to verse 18, verse chapter 7 of Micah. And we're going to look at two more verses, Micah 7:18-19. And I can just hear this prophet of doom, this grieving prophet who's been telling these people in the first three chapters, this message of, boy, here's how bad you are. Here's what God's judgment is. This is what's going to happen if you don't repent. Listen what he says. Who is a God like you? Pardoning iniquity. I mean, Micah 7:18-19. Who is a God like you pardoning iniquity and passing over the transgression of the remnant of his heritage? He does not retain his anger forever because he delights in mercy. He will again have compassion on us. He will subdue our iniquities and cast all of our sins into the depths of the sea. Micah found hope in God's unchanging character. Micah knew that only God could solve his sin problem. And he knew that God is gracious. He remembers his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And we know that 1 John 1:9, says if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us of all of our sins,
That's right.
cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Who is a God like you, O God?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, my lesson is on Ezekiel, so we're going to continue on that theme. But, you know, kind of taking a few steps back, much of the book of Ezekiel, the book of Ezekiel is an incredible book. It's kind of multifaceted. There's much that Ezekiel shares, much of his visions, very complex prophetic material. But also much of the book of Ezekiel is God speaking through Ezekiel, calling out the apostasy of his time. Yes. Ezekiel the prophet, along with Jeremiah, lived in what is I consider the height of the apostasy of Israel. And so when you consider, you know, these different transition periods of time in which Israel or God's people or the nations of the world were in great apostasy, many people think of, you know, cities like Sodom and Gomorrah to be the height of the great apostasy that, you know, God brought a judgment upon Sodom and Gomorrah. And if we were to ask a group of Christians, this came from the study lesson, if we were to ask a group of Christians about the sins of Sodom, chances are many would launch into a description of its various sexual sins and other forms of depravity. And that is true because when we think of that great apostate state that Sodom and Gomorrah was in that eventually brought to its end. But in considering Ezekiel chapter 16, verse 49, notice what Ezekiel, he brings about a different element to the sins of Sodom and Gomorrah that many of us may not think of. Again, Ezekiel chapter 16, verse 49. The prophet writes, "Look, this was the iniquity of your sister Sodom. She and her daughter had pride, fullness of food, and abundance of idleness. Neither did she strengthen the hand of the poor and needy." Okay? And so we don't usually think of Sodom and Gomorrah in this particular way, but it's almost like Ezekiel's focus is on the economic injustice and lack of care for those in need in this particular aspect. And the lesson brings out this question. I think it's a fair question to ask. Could it be that in the eyes of God, these economic sins were just as bad as the sexual sins? You know, sometimes in our own humanistic minds, we like to, you know, layer or you know, rank sins above another. But in God's eyes, sin is sin. And it doesn't matter what type of sin, it separates you from the Lord. And obviously, Ezekiel highlights the economic injustice and the lack of care for those who are in need. Sodom and Gomorrah very much practiced that as well. But I want to kind of take a different turn because when you think of these particular practices, much of the aspects of our lesson so far have been on, you know, the laity or the general populace. You think of just in general, we're addressing the fact that people need to give more attention to those who are in need. But most of the time, we don't think or put much thought into or expecting the leadership of the church, who are lacking in this area greatly. And it was through the prophet Ezekiel that we see that God highlights this problem even within the leadership of God's church. I'm going to take us to Ezekiel chapter 34 at this point. And I want you to see how through the prophet Ezekiel, God actually calls out his shepherds. Mm. He calls out the sheep, the shepherd of the sheep, the leaders of the church. And so I'm in Ezekiel chapter 34, beginning with verse 2 through 4. Notice what this particular text says. "Son of man, prophesy again," against. So, "Son of man, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. Prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God to the shepherds, woe to the shepherds of Israel who feed themselves. Should not the shepherds feed the flock?" So there can be a literal, very much a literal application of this as well as a spiritual application along with it. "You eat the fat and clothe yourselves with the wool. You slaughter the fatlings, but you do not feed the flock." Mm-hmm. And then verse 4, "The weak you have not strengthened, nor have you healed those who were sick, nor bound up the broken, nor brought back what was driven away, nor sought what was lost. But with force and cruelty, you have ruled them." Now, we don't usually get that type of mentality or image in our mind that the leadership of a particular church or a religious Christian group like this would be cruel and use force to rule over the people. But we have to remember, again, this was the period of probably the height of apostasy in Israel's history. These are the same people that forced God to evacuate his own holy sanctuary back in Ezekiel 11. Mm-hmm. And so God is calling them out. He's saying, look, you need to be made known of your state. And I just want to kind of take us back now. We're still in the book of Ezekiel, but I wanted to highlight and further give detail from a biblical perspective of the spiritual state that these shepherds, these leaders were in. When you get to a point where you're starting to have to call out God's leadership because they're not following God's principles and taking care or paying attention or giving or showing care to those in need, that is a result of something else. And we can see that actually highlighted very clearly in Ezekiel chapter 22. So the 22nd chapter of Ezekiel, I'm going to begin reading in verse 26 and onward. Listen to the details. Very, very much, this is very strong language here. Notice what he says. Her priests have violated my law and profane my holy things. Mm. They have not distinguished between the holy and the unholy. Mm. Mm. Nor have they made known the difference between the unclean and the clean. You know, much of what we're talking about here in this particular verse, we can say this is going on in today's time. This is very much a reflection of the many of the leadership and the ministries of today's world. It goes on to say, and they have hid their eyes from my Sabbaths, so that I am profaned among them. Her princes in her midst are like wolves tearing the prey to shed blood, to destroy people, and to get dishonest gain. Mm. Her prophets plastered them with untempered mortar, seeing false visions and divining lies for them, saying, thus saith the Lord God, when the Lord hath not spoken. Speaking on behalf of God, but yet God hath not spoken to them. But notice what the Bible continues to say. Verse 29, the people of the land have used oppressions, committed robbery, and mistreated the poor and needy, and they wrongfully oppress the stranger. So I sought for a man. Notice what God says through the prophet here. I sought for a man among them whom would make a wall and stand in the gap before me on behalf of the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found no one. He couldn't find anyone to stand up for righteousness. Therefore, I have poured out my indignation on them. I have consumed them with fire of my wrath, and I have recompensed their deeds on their own heads, says the Lord God. And so this was a very strong, strong language from God to these priests, to the leaders of Israel. And he's basically saying, look, you're not paying attention to these other major aspects of ministry. My people are in need. I need you to reach out and touch them. I need you to serve them. I need you to meet their needs. But you can't because you are so far away from me. And so God is pleading with his people. Please turn to me. Keep my commandments. Obey my principles. We also see in Ezekiel 34. So I'm going now forward into the 34th chapter of Ezekiel, and I may not read all of these texts, but I want you to see something here. There is a differentiation between what God is actually spelling out or kind of painting a clear picture here between a shepherd who is not fulfilling the deeds and the works of a shepherd, and then God highlights himself and showing himself as the God of the true shepherd that he is. Just notice the beginning verses of Ezekiel 34, starting with verse 7. It says, therefore, you shepherds, hear the word of the Lord. As I live, says the Lord God, surely because my flock became a prey and my flock became food for every beast of the field, because there was no shepherd, nor did my shepherds search for my flock, but the shepherds fed themselves and did not feed my flock. So God, he's saying, look, I need you to tend to my sheep. I need you to feed my sheep, but you're not doing this. And he calls them out for these various sins. But then jump down to verse 11. This is where God now inserts himself. He says, use me an example. I'm the true shepherd here. It says, for thus says the Lord God, verse 11, indeed, I myself will search for my sheep and seek them out. He says, you may not search for them, but I will. You may not seek them out, but I will. As a shepherd seeks out his flock on the day he is among his scattered sheep, so will I seek out my sheep and deliver them from all the places where they were scattered on a cloudy and dark day. He says, look, my sheep may be wandering in darkness, but I am right there with them. I found this interesting quote from Testimonies for the Church, volume 4, page 377. She says, the preacher who bears the sacred truth for these last days must be the opposite of all this, and by his life of prayer practical godliness plainly mark the distinction existing between the false and the true shepherd. She goes on to say, the good shepherd came to seek and to save that which was lost. He has manifested in his works his love for his sheep. All the shepherds who work under the chief shepherd will possess his characteristics. They will be meek and lowly of heart. Childlike faith brings rest to the soul and also works by love and is ever interested for others. If the Spirit of Christ dwells in them, they will be Christ-like and do the works of Christ.
Amen.
Amen. What a powerful study, each one of you. As you were talking, I was just thinking, here today, we think if a preacher preaches a straight message, ooh, that was a little harsh. They ought to read the Old Testament. They ought to read the minor and the major prophets and read the scathing, we could say, use that word, the scathing rebukes that were given. And why were they given? Because God loves his people passionately. And he wants to see them saved. He is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. When each one of you were sharing, I just saw the prophets calling to people's hearts. They've turned away from God. They're worshiping false idols. They're doing idol worship, false gods. And they're oppressing the poor. And there's such injustice going on. But yet, there's always this call for repentance. My prophet is Isaiah, not my prophet, but Thursday's lesson is on the prophet Isaiah. And thank you, Shelley, for giving me Isaiah, because I love the book of Isaiah. It's actually one of my favorite books of the prophets. Isaiah begins this section of the latter prophets, Isaiah going all the way to Malachi. It's the longest book in this section, and Isaiah used a larger vocabulary of Hebrew than any of the other Old Testament writers. It contains both prose and poetry, and even when you read it in English, it's amazing. It's just the writing of it, I love it. His name, Isaiah, means salvation of Yahweh, or God saves. He was a contemporary of Amos and Hosea and Micah, and it was written to those specifically in Judah and Jerusalem. The themes of the book of Isaiah, we see themes of salvation, judgment, which we're going to get to, remnant, Messiah. There's a lot of prophecies about the coming Messiah. And Isaiah, actually, you get to the end of the book, it takes us all the way up to the new heavens and the new earth. There's also comfort and redemption and restoration. If you kind of divide Isaiah into parts, there would be part one, which is the book of judgment. Then we have a historical interlude in the middle. And then we have part two, which is the book of comfort. So hopefully, in my remaining time, we're going to get to part one and part two. But we got to start with the book of judgment first. So turn with me to Isaiah chapter 1, verse 15. We're going to look at a lot of scriptures here from Isaiah. Isaiah 1, 15. It tells us that God refuses to see or hear his people. And why is that? Verse 15, when you spread out your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Even though you make many prayers, I will not hear. Why? Your hands are full of blood. And then he makes this appeal, verse 16, wash yourselves, make yourselves clean, put away the evil of your doings from before my eyes, cease to do evil, learn to do good, seek justice, rebuke the oppressor, defend the fatherless, plead for the widow. Verse 18, come now, he says, and let us reason together. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they're red like crimson, they shall be as wool. The people that Isaiah was talking to of that time, and we're going to look at some of the specific sins that he condemned in the book of Isaiah, but their hands were pretty red, you could say. There was a lot of sin going on in the nation of Judah at that time. But yet God's saying, I can forgive all that, I can redeem all that, and you can be white as snow again. And then there's a call, a challenge to walk in obedience. The next verse, verses 19 and 20. If you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, you shall be devoured by the sword, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. So there was a choice that the people were faced with. They could choose God's way. They could choose to repent and turn back to Him, or they can choose to walk in their own stubbornness, their own foolish pride, and there would be consequences as a result of that choice to walk against God. So let's look at some of the specific sins that Isaiah condemned. Jump over to chapter 3, verses 14 and 15. He condemns the oppression of the poor. Isaiah 3, 14 and 15. The Lord will enter into judgment with the elders of His people and His princes, for you have eaten up the vineyard. The plunder of the poor is in your houses. And what do you mean by crushing my people and grinding the faces of the poor, says the Lord of hosts. Now that's pretty strong language to not only crush people, but to literally grind their face. So he's condemning them for oppressing the poor. Isaiah 5, verse 8, he condemns them for a greed to want to get more. Isaiah 5, 8, woe to those who join house to house. They add field to field till there is no place where they may dwell alone in the midst of the land. Now, we know that money itself is not evil, but the love of money is the root of all evil. And in this case, they loved it so much they were greedy and they were trying to add house to house and field to field and land to land. There's also condemnation. We're going to Isaiah 10, verses 1 and 2. Condemnation against unjust laws and oppressive decrees, against the deprivation of the rights of the poor, against the abuse of dependent people, such as widows and orphans. So we're in Isaiah 10, 1 and 2. Woe to those who decree unrighteous decrees, who write misfortune, which they have prescribed to rob the need of justice, to take what is right from the poor of my people, that widows may be their prey, that they may rob the fatherless. So the whole first part of Isaiah is this book of judgment. Then we have the historical interlude, and my favorite part is part two. That is the book of comfort. So there are so many promises. If you look at my Bible in Isaiah, I always highlight the promises that I see in yellow, and Isaiah is just full of yellow. I love it. At the end, there's too many to enumerate, Ryan, but I'm going to give you seven. Seven promises we find here in the book of comfort. Number one, he's going to send an intercessor. This is Isaiah 59, 15, the latter part of verse 15 and the first part of verse 16. Then the Lord saw it, and it displeased him that there was no justice. He saw that there was no man and wondered that there was no intercessor. And we're going to see he sends himself as the intercessor. Isaiah 59, 16, the second part. Therefore, his own arm brought salvation for him, and his own righteousness, it sustained him. Number two, promise two, he will bring salvation, and he will bring forgiveness. Isaiah 59, 20. The Redeemer will come to Zion, and to those who turn from transgression in Jacob, says the Lord. Isaiah 55, 7, let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. He promises to send the intercessor, that's the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. He promises to bring salvation and forgiveness. He promises that he will defend us. That's number three, he will defend us. Isaiah 59, 19, the latter part of that verse. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard against him. Isaiah 54, 17. Mollie, you quote this all the time. No weapon formed against you shall prosper, but every tongue that rises up against you in judgment, you shall condemn. For this is the heritage of the servants of the Lord. Number four, he will renew his covenant with us. Isaiah 59, 21. As for me, says the Lord, this is my covenant with them. My spirit who is upon you and my words which I have put in your mouth shall not depart from your mouth, nor from the mouth of your descendants, nor from the mouth of your descendants' descendants, says the Lord, from this time and forevermore. Isaiah 54:10, for the mountains shall depart and the hills be removed, but my kindness shall not depart from you, nor shall the covenant of my peace be removed, says the Lord, who has mercy on you. Number five, moving quickly, he will grant us his righteousness. That's his character. Amen. Also, Isaiah 60:21, also your people shall all be righteous. They shall inherit the land forever, the branch of my planting, the work of my hands, that I may be glorified. Number six, he will do a new thing in our lives. Isaiah 43:18-19, don't remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and springs of water in the desert. Finally, number seven, he will grant us peace and comfort. Isaiah 52:9, break forth into joy. Sing together, you waste places of Jerusalem, for the Lord has comforted his people. He has redeemed Jerusalem. So God comes with a message, a stern message of rebuke. Mm-hmm. But if we heed, and if we turn back to him, his promises are incredible, to use a Ryan word. His promises are incredible.
Wow. That's right. I'm full.
Amen. This was
I think we could just say amen and do the benediction, but we have about a little more than 2 minutes. I'll give you an opportunity to recap what we covered this week.
You know, each one of these, looking at the prophets, they all had a stern rebuke to bring to the people that God sent them to. And I'm thinking of times when maybe we feel within ourselves that we need to speak to someone about a situation. Mm. And I just want to encourage you, if you feel that impression, make sure it's God. And then bathe it in prayer. And always, if you need to address a situation, remember how God always did it. He always gave the instruction, and then he always gave hope. He gave a message of salvation. So always bring any message. There are times when we need a stern rebuke, but always deliver it with hope and with mercy.
Amen and amen. I'm just thinking that, you know, sometimes the enemy of our souls trips us up. Sometimes somebody knocks us down. I mean, we're being oppressed. But just remember Micah 7:8-9, where Micah said, do not rejoice over me, my enemy. When I fall, I will arise. When I sit in darkness, the Lord will be a light to me.
Amen. Praise the Lord. I just want to reiterate the last couple of sentences of testimonies for the church, volume 4, page 377. I love this. It says, childlike faith brings rest to the soul and also works by love and is ever interested for others. If the Spirit of Christ dwells in them, they will be Christ-like and do the works of Christ.
Amen.
Isaiah 54:11, O you afflicted one, tossed with tempest and not comforted, the Lord will lay your stones with colorful gems and your foundations with sapphires. So no matter what you're going through, God is beside you and he will see you through.
Yeah. Wow. This week, I know when we approached this lesson, we all said, Lord, this is a big mountain. How can we summarize the life of a prophet? But God is faithful, is he not?
Amen.
Can we get an amen?
Amen.
I like those words because it means true. God's word is true and everything he has said is wonderful. We'd like to encourage you to join us next time. Our next lesson is Worship the Creator. And it's getting better and better. And the worship of the Creator is broken down into multifaceted. But if I could summarize this lesson, it's these words. 2 Chronicles 20:20, the last part. Believe in the Lord your God, and you shall be established. Believe in his prophets, and you shall prosper. God bless you until we see you again.